Hi everybody, this is Nick Schwaderer and welcome to Rails World. Today I've got four lovely speakers who are speaking at this conference here, and all the videos of their talks will be on the Rails World YouTube channel within 2 weeks, so keep your eyes out for that. We're going to have a little preview today. Welcome guests. So just to start, I'd love for you to share for the folks back at home who you are, and maybe just like a couple of lines about what your talk is at Rails World. Let's start with Kinsey and we'll go down the line.
Awesome. Yeah, I am Kinsey Durham-Grace. I am hailing from Denver, Colorado. I work for GitHub on the Copilot Coding Agent core team.
Hi, I'm Paweł Strzałkowski. I come from Warsaw, Poland. And by day, I'm the CTO of a Ruby agency called Visuality. And in Rails World this year, I'm talking about MCP, so Model Context Protocol, and how to make your Rails application into MCP server.
Great.
I'm Andrew McNamara from Shopify. I work on our agent-based systems, one of them being Sidekick, our merchant-facing LLM-based agents. I'm here with Charlie. We're going to be talking about how we build Sidekick on Rails and then a little bit about LLM evaluations rather than vibe coding. And then if we have time, some reinforcement learning and some of our learnings there.
And again, yep, I'm Charlie, Charlie Lee with Shopify. Just here to chat with Andrew on stage about Sidekick specifically.
Great, thank you so much. The theme, as you can tell here, is all things AI, Ruby and Rails and that whole universe. And I guess we'll just kick it off with Andrew with a question. You know, Ruby and Rails were developed long before anything AI existed. So it's a tool that's really optimized for developer happiness, convention and configuration. In 2025, how would you say that that language and framework suits compared to others with utilizing AI in your actual code?
Yeah, I think I'm going to pass it to Charlie for this one, who's our Rails expert.
Sure, yeah. I think Rails as convention actually helps with AI quite a bit, right? Because AI is able to pick up on patterns quite quickly, and having a lot of conventional approaches in Rails extends to that. So if you're vibe coding, for example, it's able to pick those up really quickly. If you're creating an LLM or AI-driven application, it also helps because a lot of things are very componentized within Rails, and you can extend those components with AI-specific things. So in general, I think Rails is in an amazing spot to drive LLM-related features, but also to be used directly by LLMs.
So you're kind of saying, you know, Rails from the beginning was omakase, conventions, clear rules in text, simplicity, not a lot of, you know, wild lines of code, and maybe that has kind of been a great marriage with AI.
That's exactly right. I think LLMs sometimes get lost quite frequently, the more things it has to sort of pick up and learn on the fly. So by having something that's so conventional like Rails, it becomes a bit easier for the LLMs to operate with.
Great. And if you've used AI even a little bit, you've probably heard of MCPs. And the, you know, more advanced you want to get with your LLMs and AI, whether it's for personal use or inside of your actual code, you've probably heard of MCPs. So, Paul, the question I have for you is, let's say we have an engineer at home. Maybe they use a bit of Claude Code. Maybe they use a bit of Cursor, right? Maybe they haven't built maybe like an actual agents into their code yet, but they use it for themselves. And they've heard about MCPs, they've read maybe a couple of blogs about cool tools you can use, but they just secretly don't know what is an MCP, and at this point they're too afraid to ask, right? So if they were here watching this video, how would you explain to them, maybe this is too big of a question, hopefully not, what is an MCP?
Great question, thank you. So there are so many one-liners explaining what MCP is.
Okay.
None of them actually make sense.
Okay.
But I'll give my best shot. An LLM, large language models, operates in void. It knows what it knows, and it doesn't have access to real world, up-to-date data. So in order to make it do more, let's say, or be able to do more, to suit you, more, help you more, you need to provide to a large language model additional context over an, let's say, AI native protocol. Hence, model context protocol. You give to a model additional context over AI and AI native protocol. And that's it. MCP is just a protocol. Now it's the matter how you use it, whether for development tools or for ordering pizza, you can do that. Then this is whatever you apply it for, it will do. However, in general, it's just giving additional context, especially real life, up-to-date context, to an LLM so it can reason and make decisions.
All right, I think that's a great answer. Thank you so much. Now, Kinsey, a bit of a spoiler, Kinsey's already given the talk, so I've been able to get a bit more of a preview. But what I think would be great for our engineers watching back at home is, similarly, they might be using a bit of some LLMs in their editor, a bit of Claude or something like that. But I think your talk, again, makes me think of the next level, like actually utilizing this tooling as a part of your product and your solution. If somebody were to want to get started today, but they're scared, you know, maybe they have fears about reliability, right? It's not, you know, like asserting, or even just like maybe a blog or just kind of what that first step into doing what you kind of talked about today. Do you have any tips and tricks?
As far as getting started with building an agent or?
Yeah, like actually, you know, instead of using the tooling to help you build, you know, static Rails and Ruby solutions, but actually having it in your solution.
Yeah, I definitely think there's a lot of great blog posts and YouTube videos. Another big thing that I really like to read is Anthropic's blog posts. They have really good blog posts that are not over my head and different things like that and can really help you get started. But if you want to just build an agent or dive into that, there's a lot of, you can just Google, you know, building an agent and Rails and things like that. And there are a lot of great YouTube videos around doing that.
Great. Well, thank you very much. All right, well, one final question that I have for all our panelists here is, I don't know about you at home, I feel like every 3 months, how I'm using AI just completely changes for the last 2 or 3 years. And it's always for the better, but it's rapidly changing. So I don't know if I could watch a talk from 3 years ago and have it be exactly the same as it is today. So I think we have 4 experts here in this space. I'd love to hear from each of you. How do you keep on top of all the developments in AI right now? And I'll start with Kinsey again.
Yeah, to be totally honest, I use my company work Slack. A lot of people post relevant articles on what we're working on and to keep up with the trends and learning, reading a lot of articles. I do a lot more reading, almost in a research-like way than I've ever done before, I feel like, to really stay on top of what's happening and what's the future.
Great. Paul?
Yeah, I'd say I do quite the same. So first of all, we have like in-company discussions, a lot of those every day. But also I use more and more YouTube. Probably I should be reading more, but YouTube is actually great. But as you've said, if you just leave for a month, you have to start over again and again. So it's not you. It's a common feeling between all of us. So perhaps this is what we should share as well. But for me, it's mostly YouTube. And if I find anything more interesting, I dig in, I read then later on.
Andrew?
I think Twitter is surprisingly good at this. Like if you keep on track of Twitter and follow the right people, then I think you can keep pretty on track of it. And Hacker News is also quite good. I'm pretty impressed by how Toby actually is so up to date on everything. So sometimes I just look at who Toby's following and follow them. So that might be a good idea. On the flip side of it, keeping up to date with everything is one thing, but then using it in your systems is another. So our talk talks about LLM evaluations and how you can quickly switch to new systems, quickly try new tools, and then ship them to production as quickly as possible. I think when Claude 4.1 came out, or 4 came out, we went from Claude 3 to 4 within 2 days just because of the eval system that we had. So we're going to talk a little bit about that tomorrow.
Right.
Yeah, I think also open source projects are a huge boon of ideas. A lot of times you'll find that techniques that these like production LLM providers are productionizing are actually started in open source projects, smaller ones, in fact, that you know they figured out a way to actually productionize and make it accessible for everybody. So I really like looking at open source projects that people are just putting out because you'll find just a wealth of ideas out there.
Great. Well, thank you very much. I think we have some fantastic answers for folks out there who may be using a bit of AI at work or want to get started or curious about it. So I appreciate our experts, Kinsey, Paul, Andrew, and Charlie. Thank you for being here. And once again, those talks will be online on the Rails World YouTube channel in 2 weeks. And thank you so much to Shopify for sponsoring our on-site interview booth today. And thank you very much.